Preserve the crime scene, follow the money trail, establish the motive, look for those with the means to pull off the crime. Any criminal investigator will tell you that these are the most basic principles of any investigation, but none of them were followed on 9/11. Of course, there was no serious criminal investigation, no attempt to preserve the evidence or establish the means, motive, or opportunity, no inclination to follow the money. The 9/11 Commission itself concluded that the funding of the attacks was of little practical significance. From the very first moments after the attack, the fix was in. After 10 years of research into the names and connections behind the 9/11 attack and its subsequent cover-up, Kevin Ryan has released a new book synthesizing that research. Another 19, Identifying Legitimate 9/11 Suspects, seeks to propose an alternate 19 suspects to the alleged hijackers that we have been asked to believe perpetrated the attacks that day. The list includes Dick Cheney and Donald Rumsfeld, the highest-ranking administration officials in Washington that day, and two people who had been intimately involved with continuity of government planning that was actually enacted on the morning of 9/11 and may still be in operation today: Frank Carlucci of the Bush-Bin Laden-connected Carlyle Group, Richard Armitage, who oversaw the State Department which instituted the Visa Express program through which many of the alleged hijackers obtained their visas to enter the country, Louis Free of the FBI and George Tenet of the CIA, Ralph Eberhardt, Michael Canavan, and Benedict Sliney, who helped oversee the air defense failure that morning, Rudy Giuliani, who put the emergency management office in WTC Building 7 in the years before the attack, and numerous others, including corporations like SAIC, Kroll, QAM, and Stratesec, that all had intimate ties to the events of 9/11.
So that one comes right in there, okay? You know, talking about a great follow-up to part one.
Exactly.
Okay, so, you know, they're talking about, oh, we have this official report and we've investigated it. And I'm saying bullpucky.
Well, okay? You know, they didn't investigate those other guys because they had no known ties to Al-Qaeda.
I'm Darren Howard.
And I'm Robert Nisbet.
You're tuned in to part two of our 9/11 special right here on YouTube. Let's talk about the fact there is no forensic investigation.
Well, I'm joined here in the studio now by Frank Gaffney, who's the director of the Center for Security Policy, who's in Washington. How do you think the United States will respond to this?
This is not a matter for business as usual, a judicial process, forensic investigations, and so on. I believe that we have been struck in a way that is probably going to be a precursor to even worse. And it is time for us to act as I think our friends in Israel have been doing for some time, quite correctly, which is to use such intelligence as we do have, to use such force as we have at our disposal to strike at and try to destroy these terrorists and their sponsors before they strike again. I think we ought to use this as an opportunity, as has been pointed out by others, to put them on the run. Let them know that they've got no place to hide, and such places that they hide are going to be very difficult places from which to operate against us.
A little bit later on, we're going to be talking about how the BBC was prepared for Building 7.
Yeah.
Okay, but this is just, what, 7 hours after?
Yeah. Okay. Had the first tower even fallen? I guess it had by then.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I mean, the first tower, I can't remember the exact timing on it, but it was so fast. But he's all ready to say, we don't need an investigation.
No.
We need to strike.
No judicial process, no forensic investigation.
Yeah.
We're ready to go to war.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Hurrah. But, you know, the fact that they said that, okay, I remember Richard Gere got in front of an entire group of people in New York at one of the, there was a healing thing going on. And he said, well, now's the time to think about peace. And everyone's going, no.
Yeah. There was one lone voice in the U.S. Congress that stood up and said, we got to step back.
Yeah, yeah. There was one voice that nobody will forget. He was reading a book about a goat. And now there's a little bit of a logical problem with our Mr. Bush.
Just a wee bit. Aside from his family connections to the 9/11 tragedy.
Okay, so Fahrenheit 9/11, if you haven't seen it, please, please watch it. But this.
I don't know who his handlers were, but I think they messed up.
You don't have to be a conspiracy theorist to wonder exactly what President George W. Bush knew about the attack and when he knew it. According to the official White House version, it was at this moment in a Florida classroom that Bush learned the second plane had hit the World Trade Center and that the U.S. was under attack. But here's what George Bush himself said almost 3 months later when asked about September 11th.
I was sitting outside the classroom waiting to go in, and I saw an airplane hit the tower the TV was obviously on, and I used to fly myself, and I said, well, there's one terrible pilot. And I said it must have been a horrible accident. But I was whisked off there. I didn't have much time to think about it.
Now, wait a minute. George Bush was told about the second plane while he was inside the classroom. So you just heard him describe seeing the first plane crash on television that day. But that's impossible. No one saw the first plane crash on TV on September the 11th because the videotape of it didn't surface until the next day. So how could George Bush have seen what he said he saw? Of course, there's always the possibility the president simply misspoke. He has been known to do that. But that's precisely the point. It's that kind of inconsistency, especially on the most thoroughly documented day in history, on which conspiracy theories are built.
So where were his handlers for that?
And, you know, America's under attack, so he sits there for another, 17 minutes?
Yes.
Before they hustle him out of a publicly noted place.
Yeah.
Could have been under attack, you know, but
he's reading,
let him sit there.
Yeah, and if you watch Fahrenheit 9-1-1, a guy comes in, whispers, Mr. President, the country's under attack, and then he sits there. And he sits there.
Because he didn't want to alarm the children.
I think they were disturbed enough. They had to sit there and listen to him read My Pet Goat.
Hey, look, it's W.
He can read. You see? I know it. I knew he could read. Okay, but there he is 3 months later. Where is the American news? That's a Canadian newscast. The Fifth Estate covered that.
Yeah.
Okay? And, you know, I'm still waiting for the American newscasters to come out and do a little bit of...
They were too busy scaring the American public into going to war.
Yeah, they had this awesome news and, the dramatic music and everything like that.
Oh, yeah, they had all their graphics already.
I know. Yeah, strange, eh? They had a lot of graphics ready to go.
Just seems a little odd to me.
Coming up in part three, we're going to talk about the graphics the BBC had ready for this one. But we do follow the breadcrumb trail.
That we do.
Okay. So what do you got?
Some people made a lot of money out of 9/11.
No, do tell.
In the days leading to 9/11, observers see significant insider trading at the stock markets, a strong indication of foreknowledge. Certain people are betting on falling stock prices of companies that will suffer from the attacks later on. Example, the bets on falling stock prices of the two involved airlines, United Airlines and American Airlines, generate a return of over 400% in just 1 week, in total about $16 million. Official explanation, all these trades had harmless reasons. There wasn't any insider trading regarding 9/11. The investors had no conceivable ties to Al-Qaeda. Problem? Financial experts from the University of Zurich, Switzerland, published a detailed study in 2011 proving that insider trading occurred shortly before 9/11. On the other hand, the details of the investigation of the Security and Exchange Commission on this issue have never been published. The names of the individual investors remain secret till today.
And that makes me ask the question, how could that insider trading remain secret to today?
Well, no evidence of foreknowledge there.
No.
Not at all.
I mean, it's not like there were people not going to work that day, too.
Yeah, of course, the odds of them actually making these predictions are very high. I'm not going to pull a number out of the air because I don't know what the odds are.
Yeah, I know. And I think that enough people have pulled enough out of the air on this one. As we mentioned at the beginning of this, it was loose change that started the cascade of information and analysis about it. I just saw a video that showed the plane being superimposed in the incorrect way when it went towards the building.
Yeah, so, I'm not going to go to the no planes theory because that just kind of poisons the well.
Yeah, the no planes theory is one of those ones that where you start, we got to siphon through, right? We have to say, well, that one looks a little bit cheesy. This, though, looks forensic and interesting.
Yeah, but you got to stick to the facts, the stuff you can prove.
That's right. So that's why we do what we do.
And you have to ask legitimate questions like, where was the head of the defense industry or the defense branch of the government on 9/11?
Well,
let's see.
Let's see where he was.
Where was Secretary of Defense Donald Rumsfeld on the morning of 9/11? Rumsfeld told CNN's Larry King on December 5, 2001, that he was in fact addressing a congressional delegation on the certainty of a terrorist attack in the very near future at 8 a.m. on September 11th, as the first plane hit the World Trade Center. By his own admission, after the meeting was adjourned, Rumsfeld went in to get his regular CIA briefing, which was already scheduled for 9:30. For half an hour, Rumsfeld waited in his office because he wanted to make a few phone calls. On June 1st, 2001, the Department of Defense's protocols for dealing with hijacked civil aircraft were changed. These changes made it explicit that all requests by the National Military Command Center for assistance by the Department of Defense in the event of a hijacking required the approval of the Secretary of Defense. Why were the protocols for dealing with terrorist hijackings changed just 3 months before 9/11 to specifically indicate that all requests for assistance by the Department of Defense had to be cleared with the Secretary of Defense? And how did Rumsfeld going AWOL on the morning of the most important attacks in modern US military history affect the response of NORAD that day? These are the questions that the 9/11 Commission just didn't ask.
So, you know, they were where the Pentagon got hit, they deleted or lost the, you know, money that they were investigating.
Yeah, didn't Donald Rumsfeld mention they couldn't find $2.3 trillion in defense spending?
That was the day before, right?
Yeah, that was, he made that announcement September 10th.
And then they lost the flight logs from multiple different levels of the military.
And it just so happens the plane that hit the Pentagon hit the exact part where they were doing the accounting to try and find where that $2.3 trillion got misspent. Just a coincidence, though, right?
If you scratched your head for all the coincidences that came up for 9/11, you wouldn't have a hair left on your head.
No.
Okay? Because all of a sudden, some of the most intricate and well-documented military maneuvers just went missing altogether. And forget the fact that they were running an air hijacking drill at the exact same moment
that the actual hijacking was going on. I know, just an odd coincidence again.
Yes, I'm missing a concrete wall to ram my forehead into. This is why we do what we do. It's why I really love the internet, too, because no matter what, they cannot undo the fact that we're writing the history books and they get to read them.
Well, they're trying to revise history as much as they can.
That's why we're here. I'm Darren Howard.
And I'm Robert Nisbet.
We got one more segment coming up on 9/11. As usual, we're saying check our facts because, hey, we're just a couple guys in the studio doing our power block, and we call it video radio.
That is right.
Ah. Coming up next, we're going to talk about videos. We're going to talk a bit about Building 7. But we are telling you, start up your own radio station. Get your own newspaper and get it going because you are the person that counts. You're the person who's informed and talks about facts. That's right.
That's right. And don't get your information from the mainstream media.
Now, also, we've got another documentary coming up called Warriors and Thieves. Stay tuned for that. But stay tuned. One more segment coming up with Radio Free Canada and 9/11. Canada used to have what is called a social safety net. That net used to consist of welfare and UI checks, and it ensured that people would not have to steal to live. But now there are no effective social safety nets left, except for the richest of the rich. How does it work? Well, it's pretty simple. Major corporations are awarded subsidies, tax breaks, and eased regulations, and you are not. Not convinced? Just remember that you pay 65% of your wages in taxes, and Canadian banks, corporations, pay no taxes at all. But things are changing. From Egypt to Toronto, from Victoria to Halifax, people are winning battles by standing up for what is right. People like me and you. On January 28th, we are asking you to go to your city hall at 12 noon all across the country. Spread this video around and stand up against corporate welfare and get our safe streets back in an effective way.